You can have a seat.
Good morning, First Service people.
Glad you guys are here and getting us awake this morning. I'm kind of foggy. I feel foggy. It's kind of rainy kind of weekend. And so you guys got to liven it up a little bit. You know, in youth ministry, for 25 years I served in youth ministry, we had motions for every song. This song is a great one for that. When it says on the chorus, "I am free to run," you know, you can do this in your seat. You don't have to do much. You just do this. That's your run. And then it says, "I'm free to dance." And I always do the little this. I do that. So if you guys want to throw those out, feel free to do that this morning. Welcome to Oakwood Community Church. We're glad you're with us this morning. We want to welcome all visitors. If you're visiting with us for the first time, we have a gift for you. We love first-time visitors here. And if you fill out the little tear-off tab that's in the bulletin and take it to that counter afterward, we have this gift bag for you. In that gift bag, we have a little coffee mug that's full of goodies and things that we just want to thank you and say thank you for joining us this morning. And if you don't have a church home of your own, we'd love for you to consider Oakwood. Make Oakwood your family. I believe that is it. I'm going to just have a word of prayer and turn it right back over for us to worship this morning. Let's pray together. Father God, thank you for this day. God, I'm thankful with the hard storms of even last night, the people in the pier are okay, and those who were hit by winds. And God, I'm just thankful that they're able to be here this morning. And God, that we just love how you refresh our earth and give us rain and take good care of your world, God. We're thankful for what happened yesterday. We were able to have good weather for our SOS ministry. God, I just pray that the people of this church would be blessed as we watch the video during our offering time of all the people that were doing work yesterday, serving in our community and making a difference. So, God, just help us to be thankful today that we have a church that cares. And help us to give to that church. Help us to support the ministries here. And God, I pray more than anything else this morning, you'd be honored and glorified. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand and join as we worship.
Amen. I don't know. I see one person there in the back wearing a green Spartan shirt.
Go green!
Looking around the room, though, I don't see any Michigan shirts. I don't understand what happened. Good game, though, wasn't it? No response. All right. This is the great thing about two services. I can try it out on the first one, and if it doesn't work, not doing it in the second one. Hey, you know what? Our God does not change. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and he is worthy of our praise. Amen? Yeah. Man, let's sing that song, "I Am Free," again.
See.
means we're free from addiction. That means we're free from hang-ups. That means we are free to be who God has created us to be. Amen? Amen. Free to live for Him. Free to live out loud. Let's sing that again. I am free. Freedom in Christ this morning. Hallelujah. Let's sing about the beautiful one.
Beautiful one, I
the beautiful one I adore. The beautiful one my soul must see. Amen. Amen. I believe we're going to take the offering now. God, I thank you, Lord, for the things that you give us, Lord, the ways that you bless us in our lives. God, it's an honor and a privilege to be able to give back to you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Man, fantastic job. Way to go. Stand with us now, if you will. Please stand if you would like to. It's more of a command. I just want to invite you to worship with us this morning. The Bible says in the book of Acts, chapter 4, verse 12, salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. Amen. He is mighty to save. Let's sing that this morning. Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Oh, love may fall on me. Here we go. Everyone needs forgiveness, kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Oh, Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Oh, Savior, he can move the mountains. Thy God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing.
Magnificent God. Amen. Amen. God, you are mighty to save this morning. We love you for that. Lord, there's nothing that we could do to earn our salvation. God, you just provided it free and clear for us. And we thank you for that this morning. It's a gift, God, that we did not deserve, but Lord, you freely gave us. Hallelujah.
Lord, I confess now in you I find my rest, and without you I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart.
Let's sing that again. Lord, I come.
You're the one that temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Before you sit down, who here needs Jesus in their life? All right, amen. You can have a seat then. Thank you, Kevin. Thank you, praise team. Appreciate your help today. Well, as you can tell from the fire on the screen behind me, it's time for a fireside chat. It's been a while. We're not going to do these every week, but every once in a while, I just want to communicate with you. By not having announcements in our service, we're hoping you're getting those announcements. We're sending those out many different ways during the week. You can always go to the church website any time of the week and watch the latest update of announcements there so you can know how to plug in. But I just wanted to talk a little bit about yesterday. I'm going to tell you, I'm a big fan of SOS. It was a dream of mine. Years ago when I came here, the board asked, what would you want to bring here? That was one of the things they'd ask, and I said right away, I'd been involved in something like this in Battle Creek, not at our church, but at another church in town. I loved it and would like to bring it. And it was interesting. I heard comments, that might not work on the east side. See, on the east side of the state, we're busier over here and people won't serve. And I understand. I get it. It's a higher pace. It is a higher pace here. But serving is serving. Whether we're busy or not, serving others is kind of at the core of who we are. And so I'm just a big fan of what we do here with our SOS, Serve on Saturday. And you can't make everyone, I understand that, because we are all busy and we all have things that we have to do at certain times. But we have enough of them that you can plug in when you can plug in. It wasn't on the screen, but we actually had an SOT this week, a Serve on Tuesday. I had a crew that couldn't meet on Saturday to do one of the projects, so they met on Tuesday night without me and got it done. And so I love that. They make it work. But I just want to let you guys know as a church how proud I am as a pastor that we not only serve one another, but we serve out in our community to people we don't even know. I think that's such a great thing. My mom and dad are in town this weekend, and my dad asked, he said, I see your announcements every once in a while. I got that Serve on Saturday thing. Is that where you guys come to the church and you work on the church? I'm like, no. No, we've never worked on the church. He's like, what? He said, that's a work day, right? I said, yeah. He said, well, you come to the church and you clean up the church and you do it. And I said, no. No, we never do that. We go out. We go out. Yesterday, a 95-year-old grandma was served. Doesn't go to our church, but a 95-year-old grandma was served. One of our youth leaders, Bruce Grace, had a troubled past, and when he was 15 and 16 years old, he was taken in by a lady who cared for him. He was down and out and pretty much set aside. Nobody thought he'd amount to anything, but somebody took him in. And yesterday, Bruce led a group of people to help at her house. That's a good thing. I took a group of people over to a friend of somebody at our church who been in a motorcycle accident. He should have died. He showed us all his scars, and I couldn't believe it. I, man, you should be dead. He started talking about all the parts they removed, not from his bike, but from his body. And I'm like, man, you should be dead. And he couldn't move. He's still in a big neck brace and his arm's in a cast and he couldn't move that. And there we were. We were going through the house changing light bulbs and fixtures in the bathroom and different things. It's a good thing. And I just want to let you know how proud I am to be a pastor of a church who cares outside of these walls. And I thank you for your service. Keep that ministry up. Let's keep serving in our community. Christmas is coming, and we are planning on an SOS project to help our House of Providence girls. We're going to do the same thing this year. We're going to buy their Christmas presents. We're going to let you take the presents you would like to purchase off the tree. We'll have that set up in December. That's coming up. But then I'm sure in January or early February, we'll have a next SOS. Try to get involved. Listen for those ahead of time and save your Saturday so you can jump in and be involved with our SOS. What's next? It's not an SOS project. It's more of our events team. It's our Harvest Festival. Why do we do that? Why do we do this Harvest Festival? Well, it's an opportunity for our church just to tell the community, come here. Come here. We want to love on you. We want to give you things and just serve you and be a friendly place. And some people might not understand how important that is to just open the doors and say, community, come in. Come in and look at what we have here and see who we are. But we just want to love on you. It's free. Just come enjoy. Drink our cider, eat our donuts, eat our popcorn, and get the kids high on cotton candy. Let them go hog wild. Have a great time here at Oakwood. Why? Well, we hope that people come and say, well, this church loves kids. This church has fun. I love that. This church is not afraid to take up their chairs and put in bouncy houses in their worship center so that kids can have a good time. That's a good thing. So we need you. We need you like we need you in SOS. We're hoping to have 50 cars out in that parking lot for our trunk or treat. 50 cars in the circle, just handing out candy. We've got themes for those. You just decorate your trunk in a theme of some kind. We have a little contest in-house. The best trunk wins a prize. But start thinking ahead. What could your trunk be? And then we need volunteers all around serving in food and bouncy houses and hay mazes and face painting. There's all sorts of things happening here on that Sunday, October 29th, the Sunday right before Halloween from 4 to 6. We need you. So consider doing that. And if you know you can't be a part of that, you can always bring candy. We need candy donations. Just bring in bags of candy to the office. I promise I don't get into them. I know you doubt that because I have a animal cracker thing. But don't bring animal crackers. Just bring candy, and we'll use those for the Harvest Fellowship or Harvest Outreach. Well, this morning, we have a great passage of Scripture to talk through in James. Get your Bibles open to James. We're now in chapter 2. And as you're opening there, turning on your gadgets, we're going to pray. Ask God to bless us as we get into the Word this morning. Would you pray with me? I'd ask that you'd pray this. You don't have to say anything out loud, but I'd ask that you'd just say, God, if there's anything you want me to hear this morning, I'm willing to listen. God, if there's anything you want me to hear, I'm willing to listen. And God, I pray that you would be glorified, that the people that came this morning would be edified, and God, that Satan would be horrified in Jesus' name. Amen. James chapter 2. James does not mince words, and James does not go slow. We've started in already, and we're talking about real faith. Everybody say real faith. And real life. Everybody say real life. Now, this first service needs to get here early and get some more coffee because you're a little bit slow this morning. So we got to, everybody say, real faith, real life. And James challenges us to be authentic, and that's very important. Is it real or not? Is it real or not? And James last week talked about be not just hearers, but doers. We need to hear the word. Don't neglect hearing the word. That was not James saying, don't worry about hearing the word. No, he's saying, don't just hear the word. Do what it says. Very practical, the book of James. Very in your face. And this week, boy, James goes at it. Matter of fact, I've studied and I started thinking, why is James so upset this week? It seemed like he's just really on it. And then I realized something, and I'll share with you in a moment about who James is in relationship with the first church. But let's look at James chapter 2. Let me read the whole thing for us. I like it when we could read the whole context. James 2, 1 through 13. My brothers, and of course that term is a term of endearment for all Christians, so it's my brothers, my sisters, show no partiality as you hold the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glory of the Lord of glory. For if a man wearing a gold ring and fine clothes come into your assembly, and a poor man in shabby clothing also comes in, and if you pay attention to the one who wears the fine clothing and say, you sit here in a good place, while you say to the poor man, you stand over there or sit down at my feet, have you not then made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters. Has not God chosen those who are poor in the world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom, which he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Are not the rich ones who oppress you and the ones who drag you into court? Are they not the ones who blaspheme and honor the name by which you were called? If you really fulfill the royal law, according to Scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You're doing well. But if you show partiality, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become guilty of all of it. For he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. If you do not commit adultery but you do murder, you become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so act as those who are to be judged under the law of liberty. For judgment is without mercy to one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. May God add his blessing to the reading of Scripture. This morning, the message is entitled, the big idea, the big thought is authentic faith shows no favoritism. Authentic faith shows no favoritism. We're going to talk about partiality. We're going to talk about the sin of discrimination. We're going to talk a little bit about the sin of being racist or preferring one social class above another social class. We're gonna talk about what James talks about as sin. And it's sin in the church. He's specifically concerned about sin in the church. He's not worried about the country or the nation at this point. He's saying in the church of Jesus, you're showing favoritism. You're showing discrimination against people. And that should not be. We want to learn that today. Matter of fact, in your notes, I think there should be 4 points. You can write right next to the 4 points if you want to. The first point is the what. Everybody say the what. The second point is the why. Good. The next one is the wrong way. Everybody say wrong way. And the fourth one is the better way. Everybody say better way. We got the what, the why, the wrong way, and the better way today. James lays it out very clearly, very logically today. So I hope you follow along as we go. I want to point to you the links again between Jesus and James. This is very clear in this passage. James, in the last verse of what we're preaching today, says, judgment is without mercy to the one who shows no mercy. Where had he ever heard this about mercy and mercy being something that's important? Again, we go back to the Beatitudes, the Sermon on the Mount. What did Jesus say? Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Once again, little brother James looking up to big brother Jesus and hearing what he had taught. And he's focusing in now about us being people who show mercy to all people. Not just people we choose, but show mercy to all people. And then I found this quote this week because this has to do with your mentality. I don't know where you're at with this whole thing about partiality. Maybe this morning you're going to find out that you do discriminate. Didn't even know you did, but maybe you're going to find out that you do have favorites and non-favorites. You love to show mercy to certain people, but not all people. And maybe this morning you're going to leave and really have to do a gut check. Well, it starts with your mind. Where is your mind? I'm afraid in the church, there's a moralist mindset, not necessarily a Christian mindset. And Tim Keller, he's a pastor in New York City, Tim Keller quoted this about the moralist mindset and the Christian mindset. The moralist mindset says this, a merely religious person who believes God will favor him because of his morality and respectability will ordinarily have contempt for the outcast. Well, I worked hard to get where I am, and so can everyone else. Well, that creeps into the church. This mindset that we're the good people, we behave better. We're not wild people. We're not those people. And I don't know what you're defining those as, but we're not those people. And the moralist mindset is very dangerous in the church, that we think we're better than other castes of people because we act better, or we we dress a little better, or we don't do some of the things that people would do. We're better. And because we're better, God loves us more. That's a dangerous, dangerous place to be. In contrast to this, Tim Keller points out the Christian's heart. The Christian's heart says, I am only here, I am only where I am by the sheer unmerited mercy of God. I am completely equal with all other people. A sensitive social conscience and a life poured out in deeds of mercy to the needy is the inevitable sign of a person who has grasped the doctrine of God's grace. Why do I think SOS is important? Because it shows the heart and the mind of the people of Oakwood. We serve. We serve each other. We serve others. We serve motorcycle guys who crash their bikes. And we serve 94-year-old grandmothers. We serve others, not because they deserve it, but because we don't deserve anything ourselves, but have been given so much. For those who've been shown great mercy, much mercy should be shown. I mean, that's just the key of the gospel this morning. So I hope you can appreciate the difference between the moralist mind and the Christian mind and heart. I love testimonies. When people come in and talk about their life that was terrible drug addiction and down and out alcoholism on the streets. I mean, I love those testimonies about people who were like the lowest and the lowest and the lowest and they found Jesus. Don't you love those? That warms my soul when I hear about them. But you know what? That's not that surprising. It isn't. I mean, that's really not that surprising. When somebody knows they're that lost, when they look in the mirror and say, I'm a mess, I've got addictions and I've got problems, I've hurt people. You know, it's not a far stretch for that person to say, I need Jesus. And we get excited when we hear those stories. But you know what really excites me? I get excited when the moralist finds Jesus. That to me is a rescue story, because it's much harder for the good person to think they need Jesus than it is for the dramatically lost person to know they need Jesus. Are you with me? Does that make sense to you? It makes sense to me that somebody in their lostness says, I am at the bottom of the bottom and I need help. I need a hand up. Help me, Jesus. That makes sense to me. And we should be excited about that, but it doesn't floor me. I just get excited that there's a life changed. What floors me is when somebody who's been in church for 25 years wakes up and realizes, this has just been something I've been doing, and it's not in here. I feel like I'm pretty good. I don't need much of anything. I'm all right. I'm already there. I'm good. God loves me. Of course he loves me. How could he not love me? Brokenness is for those drug addicts. No, let me tell you, brokenness is for all of us. You know what floors me and gets me excited? Is when the deacon walks the aisle and says, I need Jesus. When an elder walks forward and says, you know what? I need Jesus to be my Savior. That's what floors me, because how hard is that? I grew up in a church, a good Bible preaching church, and they all thought I was a Christian, and I faked it. I did that whole thing. I knew how to act Christian. I did. I knew how to act. Comply to get by. You know, we learn that. We teach that kind of in church without wanting to. Comply to get by. Our kids, pray to God your kids don't grow up with that mentality. I just got to comply to get by. I'll do what they say, I'll do what they want so I don't cause any ruffle feathers, and then when I get to be 18, I'll do what I want. And that's a dangerous thing in the church. But I'm amazed and floored when somebody who thinks they're good comes to find out they have just as much need as the one who's down and out. Oh, that God would grab us today and listen to James, and we'll move on to the first point. Number one, James teaches, I must not discriminate. Everybody say discriminate. There's three words. I loved all three of these words. We can use the word discriminate, or we could do the positive side of that, favoritism, or we could use partiality. All of these are used. James uses the word partiality, so as we read it, that's what James is saying. Verses 1 through 3, my brothers and sisters, show no partiality as you hold to the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. For if a man wearing a gold ring and fine clothes comes into your assembly, and a poor man in shabby clothes comes in, and you pay no attention to the one who wears the fine clothing, and say, you sit here in a good place, while you say to the poor man, you stand there or sit down at my feet. James is talking about blatant discrimination. Friends, as Christians, write this down if it's not in your notes already. I will not withhold love, friendship, kindness, hospitality to anyone based on external appearance. That needs to be your heart and your mind. I will not withhold love, friendship, kindness, or hospitality to anyone based on external experiences. I'm talking black and white. I'm talking brown and white. And I'm talking poor and rich. I'm talking middle class and not so middle class. It doesn't matter. We're not just talking racial this morning, although there's a definite element of racism. We're talking about showing preference to people based on something they can do for you, not on who they are. It's based on what you perceive them to be. And James says there's no room for it. Don't do it. In the church, if somebody wearing fine clothes comes in and you say, "Oh, look who's here." And then some poor guy comes in and you're like, "Yeah, go sit in the back." Or worse, I love how James says it. "Sit here at my feet like a dog." Like a dog. Shame on the church. You would say, "Oh, that never would happen." Yes, it happens. I got sent to California years ago. It's probably 10, 15 years into my youth ministry in Battle Creek, Michigan, and the Church of California, they wanted me to come. They flew us out to California. They offered all sorts of things, and they sent us on a vacation. They were really trying to get Julie and I to move to California to be the pastor of this church. And the coolest thing is, Chuck Norris's brother went to that church. They told me that, one of the first things. Hey, like, you know, you just need to know, Chuck Norris's brother comes to our church. Every once in a while, Chuck will come. And I'm going to tell you, I was like, "Ooh, Chuck Norris, that'd be awesome, that'd be so sweet. I'd love to be around Chuck Norris." And then I remember when I went to church the first time to preach and I hadn't met any of the people, you better know, the first thing I wanted to know is, which one's Chuck Norris's brother? Which one's Chuck Norris's brother? I want to know where he's at. Where's he at? Where's Chuck Norris's brother? And then I thought about it for a while and I thought, how foolish is this? You know, not even Chuck Norris, it's just his brother, you know? It's his brother. He probably doesn't even know karate, you know? Chuck Norris is his brother. He probably couldn't even break my hand when he shook it, you know? Chuck Norris could. But I had in my mind this idea, wouldn't it be cool to be a pastor of a church where a star's brother came to church and maybe we could get a glimpse of the Chuck himself? I really thought about that for a while. I thought, you know, that's wrong thinking, isn't it? That's wrong thinking. James says somebody in fine clothes or belongs to Hollywood or has a famous in-law comes to your church. How do you treat them? Do you go crazy and offer them the best seats? And then somebody with nothing comes in and maybe they're dirty and maybe they smell funny and we're like, oh, we don't want... That's not what we're looking for. We want Chuck's brother. Shame on the church. Show no partiality. I've shared this before, but when I was a child, I remember going to church on a Sunday night. Yes, we went to church on Sunday morning three times. Sunday night and then Wednesday night. We went to church a lot. I went to church on a Sunday night, and I remember walking up the stairs to the church, and I remember behind me was a man coming in, and he didn't have a shirt on. He was shirtless. Had never seen him before. And I remember thinking to myself as a young guy, this is weird. Wonder what they're going to do. And before he got to the top stairs, one of the deacons stopped him and said, "Sir, you can't come in. You're not allowed to be here. You need to find a shirt." And I remember seeing the man turn around and walk away. And as a young man, I walked into church that night and I knew something wrong just happened. I knew something wrong had happened. I'm not saying I want you to all come shirtless. This is not a shirtless church. Don't get me wrong. There's appropriateness. But as a church, even as a young boy, I think God had his hands on me and it was showing me things about being a pastor as a young man. I knew, why didn't somebody get him a shirt? Why is our response not good enough? Go away. Why would that ever be the answer for the church? Why would we ever say those words, "Go away"? We never. "I'll give you my shirt. Come in. You're welcome here." And that's what I thought about it this week. Why is James so passionate about this? And then I realized, do you remember, James was one of the pastors of the first church in Acts. Remember when that great thing happened and Pentecost came and thousands were being saved. One of the pastors that was there was James. James had then believed in Jesus, and after Jesus' death and resurrection, James is one of the leaders of the church. And I want to take a look just with me. Follow me quickly. Acts chapter 2. Let's go to Acts chapter 2, verse 45. Let's read about that first church. Acts 2 and verse 45. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as had need. That's the first church. The first church, they were sharing everything they had. Everybody was even. Everybody was equal, and they didn't have anything. Matter of fact, in Acts 4, 32, look at Acts 4, verse 32. Now the full number of those who believed were of one heart, soul, and no one said that any of the things that belonged to him was his own, but they had everything in common. What? The first church loved everybody. And if you were a follower of Jesus, you were one of them, equal. And James was a part of that church. He's a pastor of that church, seeing that nobody can, you know, that's hard today. You can say everything I've got is yours. That's easy to say if you drive my Tahoe. That's easy for me to say. I got 380,000 miles on that Tahoe out there. I have no problem saying, Mike, you want my Tahoe? You just go drive it. You can take it home. Take it home. But if I owned a Ferrari, no, Mike. It's a little harder for those who have a lot to say. It's not mine. God gave it to me. Let's share. Everybody had things. We had one heart once. James is a pastor of that kind of church. Whoo! To be a pastor of that kind of church. I love it. And we're not talking about communism. We're talking about commonism. The first church wasn't a communist church, a socialist church, but it was a common church. Everybody was the same and everybody was equal. It was groundbreaking. Can you imagine what it was like when the first church and all followers came? They talk about it. Paul talks about it. Some were slaves. Some were slave owners. I know that's a long time ago and you're like, that slavery is wrong. We all agree slavery is wrong. But in that culture, there was more slaves per capita than there were free people. It was a slave-ridden culture. But all people were invited to the gospel, and all people were welcome in the church. The slave was welcome. So was the slave owner. Can you imagine the morning when the slave owner's getting up, putting on his fine clothes, getting in his nice chariot, heading off to the group? He's heading to church. At the same time, in his little outhouse outside, the slave is getting up and getting ready to go to church. Can you imagine being in that first church where the slave showed up and the slave owner showed up, and they were equal? Matter of fact, wouldn't it be great if the slave was an elder in that church? Can you imagine when it was time to take communion and the slave handing his owner the body and the blood of Jesus Christ? And there was commonality. It was the way the church was supposed to be. We loved everybody. We were equal. Here, we're equal. What a great thing. And James was part of it. He saw it working. And then he started seeing the church disintegrate into partiality, favoritism. That's the what. What's the what? The what is, I must not discriminate. Everybody say discriminate. The next point is the why. Everybody say the why. You got to do this because y'all, who has children? After you explain the what, you're always going to hear about why. How many parents have heard that question before? But why? You know? And I don't know about you, but my dad was just the classic. He didn't hit. I was the baby of the family, so by the time I got there, he'd had two already that had asked why a million times. So by the time I came along, and I said, but why? Because I said so. How many of you have used that answer before? It works, because I said so. And that was good enough. My dad didn't expect any more talk. He had said it, the what. Everybody said the what. I'd ask the why. Everybody say why. And he answered me. James gives us the what, do not show favoritism. Now he gives us the why, verses 4 through 5. Have you not then made distinctions among yourself and become judges with evil thoughts? Another way to interpret that word is evil intent. Listen, my brothers and sisters, has not God chosen those who are poor in the world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom, which he has promised to those who love him? Why is discrimination so wrong? Why is showing favoritism in the church so wrong? Why is racism absolutely sin? Because it's the antithesis of the gospel. There's nothing more drastically different than the gospel than racism. There's nothing more differently drastic than the gospel than showing favoritism. Because the gospel of Jesus Christ is that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and that all who believe might be saved. All. Everybody say all. Doesn't matter if you're black or white. Doesn't matter if you're rich or poor. Doesn't matter if you're of the social class. Doesn't matter if you're educated or non-educated. None of it matters, because the gospel does not discriminate. When we show favoritism and racism and discrimination, we are in the face of a holy God, absolutely opposite of him. Absolutely. And it will not do. The church has to be a place where we love everybody, of all classes, social status, colors, weights. We cannot discriminate, because God does not discriminate. Amen? You young kids, this is going to seem weird to you. I'm going to talk to the Powers kids. Back when I was a kid, we would meet and go outside and play. It's freaky, I know. But we used to get together. All the kids in the neighborhood would come together, and we would play games outside. And they're probably thinking, well, yeah, you had batteries on your... No, we went outside to play, and we would pick teams. How many of you have ever gone through that horrific thing of picking teams? One of the worst things ever. We were awful, because you talk about discrimination. You talk about partiality. What is the purpose of picking teams? We picked two captains who were the best of the best, the strongest of the best, and they picked who? The best of the best. Who gets to pick first? You either did that, or you did the, rock, paper, scissors, shoot, I don't know, but we found out which of the best of the best got to pick first of the best of the best, because picking teams meant the last ones picked were always the worst. Man, that's awful. See, the kids today are like, yeah, you guys were awful. That's why we stay inside and play video games. It was awful. I'm not going to talk about which I was, the best of the best or the last to be picked, but you know where you fell. And all of us should hate that moment when we're picked last. Picked last. Oh, there's a song I want to play for you today. Don't discriminate or be racist, or I'll play more music. It's a punishment if you're not good. This is a classic song. It has to do with that very moment and what we used to do of picking the best and leaving the worst. The song about baseball. Stay.
Saturday summers, when I was a kid, we'd run to the schoolyard, and here's what we did. Pick out the captains, we choose up the teams. It was always a measure of my self-esteem, 'cause the fastest and strongest played shortstop and first, and the last ones they picked were the worst. I never needed to ask, it was sealed. I just took up my place in right field. You can be awkward, you can be slow. That's why I'm here in right field, just watching the dandelions grow. Playing right field can be lonely and dull. Little leagues never have lefties that pull. I dream of the day when they hit one my way. They never did, but still I would pray that I'd make a fantastic catch on the run and not lose the ball in the sun. And then I'd wake from this long reverie and pray that the ball never came out to me. Here in right field, it's easy, you can be awkward, you can be slow. That's why I'm here in right field, just watching the dandelions grow.
Nobody's gonna sing along?
All right, I'll just finish the song.
Off in the distance, the game's dragging on. There's strikes on the batter, some runners are on. I don't know the inning, I've forgotten the score. The whole team is yelling, and I don't know what for. Suddenly, everyone's looking at me. My mind has been wondering, what could it be? They point to the sky, and I look up above as a baseball falls into my glove. Here in right field, it's important you know. You gotta know how to catch, you gotta know how to throw. That's why I'm here in right field, watching the dandelions grow.
That's a classic song, those of you who know Peter, Paul, and Mary. Classic song about what happens in the playground. And we do, we pick teams. And I want to let you know this morning, God doesn't pick teams that way. God doesn't show favoritism. Matter of fact, God's totally different. Look at 1 Corinthians with me. 1 Corinthians 1, 26-28, here's how God picks teams. For considering your calling, brothers, not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to things nothings, bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. And because of him, you are in Christ Jesus. God doesn't pick teams the way we pick teams. We pick the best. We pick the best to be the pickers, and the pickers pick the best. And we wait to the end, and we leave those who aren't worth anything. Shame on us. Should never happen. Don't let it happen. Man, if you're ever somewhere and they start picking teams, stop and say, no, let's do this differently. Let's do it differently. Never do that to kids. Never do that to anybody. Nobody should have to be picked last. But what God did was a beautiful thing. He always picks the last first. He always picks the unnoble and the ungreat things to be his. Why did he choose his disciples? They were fishermen, and they weren't even good at it. He had to show up and say, hey, cast your net on the other side of the boat. They weren't even good fishermen. And God's like, you'll be perfect. Who's going to write half of the New Testament and be a leader in the church? How about the guy that's killing Christians? Let's pick him. We choose Paul. God always chooses lowly things because he never wants you to think it's about you. It's never about me. He wants you to know that it's him that does it, not you. So God picks all of us. He chose us in Jesus Christ. You see, people make stuff. Everybody say stuff. So we can have favorite stuff. Don't we have favorite stuff? When we go to a restaurant, the first question my wife asks the waitress is, Coke or Pepsi? If she says Pepsi, we all have water with lemon in it. But if she says Coke, yes, Diet Coke with lime. We have our favorites. And it's okay to have favorites. Coffee. I took them everywhere. Everywhere we went this past weekend, my dad and mom were like, how come there's a coffee shop everywhere you go? I'm like, because we went the long way to get there. They don't know. And I showed my dad about a pour over, fresh ground pour over at a bean to go. It's heaven. It's God's juice given to us on earth. My dad's like, what is this thing? It's a pour over. He says, that's how they make Folgers? I'm like, that's not Folgers. See, we can have our favorite coffee. We can have our favorite soft drink. We can have our favorite pizza. I'm a big fan of Gino's East Pizza in Chicago. I know a lot of y'all go downtown Chicago, you make a mistake going to Giordano's, the tourist place. You can go to the tourist place if you want. Giordano's is pizza. Gino's East is God's pizza. When I go to Chicago, I stop and have God's coffee, and I stop and have God's pizza with a Coke, Diet Coke, lime on the side. We can have favorites. Why? Because people make stuff. Everybody say stuff. But God makes people. No favorites. Did you hear that? Did you see what it did there? People make stuff. You go ahead and pick your favorite. We come to church and we want our favorites. And you know, it's just part of the church. We just asked Chris Carr to be our worship director. Good luck with that, son. Because he knows everybody has an opinion on music, amen? Everybody has an opinion on how loud it should be, how soft it should be. Everybody has an opinion on what style should be, how long ago it was written, how we perform it, how many instruments. We all have our opinions. That's favoritism. That's stuff because it's stuff. But I'm telling you, people make stuff. You can have your favorites. God makes people, no favorites. If God made it, it's my favorite. Black, my favorite. Brown, it's my favorite. Yellow, it's my favorite. Why? It's God made it. People didn't make it. See, people have the right to label things. Two kinds of people can label something. The manufacturer, right? What is yours called? What's the Chevy Cruze? Did you get to name it? He didn't get to name it. But the manufacturer named the Chevy Cruze the Cruze. They looked at the car and they said, it's a Cruze. They had the right to do that. They built it. The manufacturer. Everybody say manufacturer. Now, you know who else gets to name something or label something? The purchaser. The purchaser can do it. Because if I bought a Cruze, I'm probably not going to call it the Cruze. I'm probably going to call it Melanie. I don't know. I'm going to probably call it, you know, something. I'm going to name it, right? Because how many of you named your cars or bikes? Did you name your bike, Stan? My bikes are named Blessing and Abundance. That's my motorcycle's names, Blessing and Abundance. See, I have the right to name them. It's mine. They're my bikes. The manufacturer named it Heritage Softail. What's the other one? What's the other thing I have? Sportster. The manufacturer said, it's a Heritage. It's a Sportster. I got it, and I said, that's Blessings. That's Abundance. See, the manufacturer can name it, and so can the purchaser. Can I wake us up to the fact that God is both manufacturer and purchaser? God has the only right to label anybody. And God said, I made you, and I bought you back with a price, the blood of my son, Jesus Christ. And so I'll label you. Nobody else can label anybody. Be it black, white, yellow, brown, fat, tall, short, skinny, rich, medium, broke. Don't do it. We must never discriminate. The third thing, I must never despise my eternal brother while desiring acceptance from the world. This is the wrong way. James tells the church, be careful. Somebody comes in with fine clothes and earrings and rings on their fingers. He was really pointing out something that was happening. Did you know that in the early church in Jerusalem, and they were spread out all over the place, but they had begun trying to distinguish who they were and how much they were worth. And they were actually people that would rent rings. That was a business you could have in the first church. You would rent rings. So on church-going day, you could head to church and go to the ring renter and rent rings to put on your finger. Why? Because you wanted to show up with status. You wanted to walk in and have everybody say, oh, they rented rings. Can you imagine that? And James is saying, don't show partiality to that guy showing up with the fine rings. Care about all people. Don't label people. If God made it, show favoritism to that. Doesn't matter who they are or what they're worth. God did it. It's worth all things. He says, never despise the eternal brother while desiring acceptance from the world. But we got to make sure that fellow believers are loved in the church, no matter rich or poor. We got to love them. Don't be so caught up in what people think about you outside, your status outside. This is fleeting. This world is temporary. Don't get caught up on how you're perceived by the lost people in this world. Love your brother in Jesus Christ. Serve your brother in Jesus Christ with everything you've got. Why? Don't just be hearers. Be doers, James says. And this shows whether we're authentic or not. This is the wrong way. The wrong way is showing partiality to somebody who can do something for you instead of loving all people with everything you've got. That's the wrong way. The better way we end with today is this. I must always seek to do the word. Just do the word. What did James say? If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you're doing well. The royal law. The number one law. What is it that matters most to the heart of God? They asked Jesus this question. What's the first and most important rule? He said, love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor. Love the Lord your God with everything you've got and love people more than you love yourself. That's the royal law. Number one, grand poobah law. That's the heart of God. So James reminds them, if you want to fulfill that royal law, love your neighbor as yourself, you're doing well. But if you show partiality, you're committing sin. Everybody say sin. James doesn't parse words. It's sin when you're racist. It's sin when you show partiality. It's sin when we discriminate and don't show love to people. It's sin. Call it what it is. And you're like, yeah, but it's not a bad sin. Do you see the illustration James uses? I love he uses to, there's adultery and there's murder. I love how he goes big. He just goes big, you know. We're talking about partiality, and everybody's sitting there going, well, that's not that bad. I mean, partiality, we'll live with that. That's an itty-bitty sin. And James is like, well, it's kind of like committing adultery and murder. If you don't commit adultery, but you do murder somebody, everybody's like, I'm not a murderer. I'm not a murderer. James makes it very clear. It doesn't matter. If you show partiality, you are sinning as bad as murdering, and you're sinning as bad as committing adultery. Sin is sin. And James says, don't do it. Don't do it. And then he ends with this. So speak and act as those who are to be judged under the law of liberty, for judgment is without mercy to the one who showed no mercy, and mercy triumphs over judgment. Back to the first thing I showed you today. Jesus said mercy receives mercy. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. James repeats it and says, no mercy, you'll receive judgment. Mercy triumphs over judgment. I want to challenge you to be people that show mercy and love for all kinds of people. I read an article this week, John Piper. I like John Piper. John Piper was responding to an article about Lecrae. Lecrae is a black artist, Christian artist. Love his music. It's great. And Lecrae has really not struggled, but Lecrae has really had to do some soul searching because he was really the white church's darling boy. Matter of fact, Newsweek wrote an article about Lecrae and called him the white Christian mascot, this black man. And Lecrae woke up one day and said, there's injustice, and there's black man's blood on the street. And so Lecrae started speaking up about injustice. And I'm not going to get political with you, try not to. But I look around the room and I don't see many who can speak to Lecrae's experience, because I can't, I'm white. And the whole article is written about white evangelicalism and the black man, and how there's a rift being torn between us. So I can't speak to what the black experience is. Black Christian, black non-Christian, black poor, black rich. I can't speak to that. But I do know this, that white evangelicalism have wrongly claimed Jesus as their own only. And we've got that little white baby with blue eyes and blonde hair sitting in the manger. When I'm here to tell you, that baby was Olive. And so I'm just going to tell you, as a white evangelical pastor, we have a long way to go. And we're not going to get there not listening to others. I'm not accepting all that's happened. If you come and talk to me in private, I'll tell you about how I feel about a lot of things. I think we should stand for the country. I stand for the flag. I've let you know that. But I also want to stand with my brother, who I've not experienced what he's experienced. I want to stand with him and find out what went wrong, or how can we help. I want to stand to make a difference. I don't ever want to be a church who the person walking up the steps is told, no, go away. You don't belong here. So I want to say to us as a church, let's never show partiality or favoritism. Let's never look at the color of one's skin or the size of the bank account and make a judgment of whether we want them or not. No, the answer is very clear. God made it, we want it. We'll argue about pizza and coffee and pop. We can do that. I don't mind that at all. Let's talk about our favorite stuff. But when it comes to people, they're our favorite because they're God's favorite. Because the gospel is simply this: Jesus Christ died so that all might be saved. that all might be able to come to repentance. Oh, it's only going to be effective for those who confess and believe, but it's for all. Amen? Amen. And so we have no other option than to say, I care. So we'll go out and serve on Saturday, and we'll go out and treat people with dignity and respect, even if we're different. The best response is going to have to be love, because love is the heart of the gospel. So I challenge you this week to go and love, maybe to listen more, but definitely love a lot more and show mercy freely. Let's pray. Praise team, would you come? Kevin, bring your team. We're going to close in prayer and we're going to sing I Am Free again, right? It's great to be free. We are free in Christ. But all people are free in Christ. Everyone who's accepted Jesus Christ is free because of the cross. Free from sin and free from bondage of sin, but should also be free to be loved equally in the church. I love that about the gospel. I pray that we're going to be a gospel-preaching church to all people. God, I pray this morning for this church. I thank you for this church. God, I don't sense that we have a partiality problem. But James warned us that even in the first church, there can rise discrimination. There can rise impartiality and favoritism. God, help us to guard ourselves. Help us not to get excited when a rich person comes and not care for those that the world would deem as outcasts. There are no outcasts. All people are equal. May we be as excited about the person who comes in that's broken, has nothing to offer this church. May we be just as excited. God, this isn't a sermon that discriminates against the rich even. We're told later in Scripture that love those who persecute you. And so, God, we love both the poor and the rich. God made it. We love it. Help us to have that attitude in life. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. Those who Christ Jesus set free are free indeed, and that freedom is not to be used indulgently. We're taught that. Our freedom is used to go and serve others. And so with your freedom in Christ, love people this week. Would you love people? Love people more than you love yourself. Look for those that are hurting and outcast. Look and see how you can be somebody who can give to them. We've been given so much. We've been blessed, haven't we? The best response is to give back. God bless. Have a great week. Go in peace.